Hello, I'm Steve with Eberspaecher. Today we are going to look at the basics for a hydronic heater. For the burner operation, the fuel supply, combustion air intake, exhaust, and the power supply and connections. If I keep these items in check, then I maintain the proper air-fuel ratio and have a heater that's reliable with less maintenance. The system is all about coolant circulation, or throughput. Now let's take a look at some coolant circuits. We have a series system, which is standard in most applications, and a parallel or multiple circuit configuration. The parallel circuit is common in automobiles in Europe. The heater will start, and once the coolant reaches temperature, then the defrost fan is activated. As the coolant continues to heat, then a thermostatic valve opens and the engine is preheated. A system like this would apply to larger applications where you are heating several items, like the engine, the fuel, and maybe hydraulic oil. Now back to the series system. We have an engine creating waste heat that is circulated through our heater core, and we use the heater fan to heat and defrost the vehicle. In this system, the heater is added in series with these components. To illustrate a point, let's add four more fan units to this circuit. Do you think that fan number one will blow warmer air than fan number five? The answer? Maybe a few degrees. I probably will not feel the difference, but I can measure it. This holds true if I have good coolant circulation. If I have a restriction, like a kinked hose or maybe a restricted fitting or valve, then my coolant is not circulating well, and fan number five is definitely blowing colder air than fan number one. The coolant is moving too slow. This is why I look for coolant leaks in the system. When the system is hot and expands, and I lose coolant, then when it cools, I have the possibility of sucking in air. If I have air trapped in the system, then the heater coolant pump may or may not be strong enough to purge the air from the system. It may also depend on where the air gets trapped. If I have done any work where the coolant system has been open, then once completed, start and run the engine. The engine circulation pump has the pressure to force the air through the system and allow it to purge into the coolant reservoir or overflow tank. Let's take a look at the Hydronic D5WSC. Here are the major components: the fuel metering pump, which can be internal or external on this model, the circulation pump, and then the overheat and temperature sensors. These monitor the temperature of the coolant when it enters the heater and as it exits. If there is a rapid rise in temperature, then the unit will overheat and shut down. This is indicating a block in the system. Otherwise, they will continuously monitor temperatures. They run parallel to each other on a graph. If they separate too far, this indicates a restriction in the system, and again, the heater will overheat and shut down. Back to the components. We have the glow pin, the flame sensor, integrated ECU, and the combustion air blower. All of the heaters have an identification label on them, a permanent one and a removable one. This allows you to locate the duplicate label in an area that may be more accessible to retrieve the information. The top two lines are the model name. Line number three is the model number. This will indicate if the fuel metering pump is internal or external. Line number four is the serial number. This is needed for all warranty claims. Line number five is fuel type, diesel or gasoline. Line number six is the electrical, 12 or 24 volt. Line number seven is the maximum heat output, and then on a coolant heater, line number eight indicates the operating pressure. We have identified the heater, now let's identify the system. If I took a look at the wire harness, red is power and brown is ground. We prefer these connections directly at the battery, protected with an inline fuse. Once my heater receives a start signal, this will power the yellow wire to the heater. The voltage should be equal on the red wire and the yellow wire. Now we look to the system. There could be parameters inside the vehicle that can affect this. On many truck applications, I may need to have the ignition switch in the off or accessory position. Maybe the parking brake must be set. On a school bus, there's an impact switch. I need to meet these parameters for the heater to operate. If the heater is not operating, make sure you are getting power down the yellow wire, asking it to run. The coolant heater can be integrated into the climate system in the vehicle, so we must understand what controls the operation. This would be like the International Max Power or the Freightliner Park Smart systems. Now let's look at low voltage disconnects, LVDs. The heater ECU will monitor high voltage and low voltage. If there is an issue, then the heater will fault and shut down. This voltage is measured at the heater. If my controller has an LVD, this is measured at the controller, not the heater. My vehicle may be equipped with an LVD. Who knows where this is measured? If you have a voltage issue, always check the battery voltage and the voltage at the heater. If there is a voltage drop, check the wiring and connections. Now on to the safety features of the heater. The heater will fault if there is a voltage issue, overheat, loss of flame, or the failure of a major component. Please remember, on a coolant heater, if I have too many overheats or start attempts, then the ECU can lock up. To correct this, I need to clear the fault codes using a code reader or EDITH, our computer diagnostics program. Let's look at the operation of the heater. There is a starting phase, running phase, and the shutdown phase. Once the heater receives the start signal, a quick safety check is done with the coolant pump, blower motor, glow pin, fuel pump, and safety sensors checking in. This takes a few seconds. The heater then goes into the first preheat, about 45 seconds. Then the fan motor starts, followed by the fuel metering pump. The first ignition attempt is about 90 seconds. If the heater does not start, then it will go into a second preheat of 45 seconds, followed by the second ignition attempt up to 90 seconds. If the heater does not start, then it creates a code 52, exceeded safety time. Remember, 10 of these and the ECU is locked. Once the heater receives the start signal, the coolant pump is activated. Remember, this is how the heater operates, by reading coolant temperature. The other thing to listen for is the fuel metering pump. If it is ticking, the heater is in ignition attempt number 1, ignition attempt number 2, or the heater should be in operation. The heater ECU does not care if it is hot or cold. If I told the heater to start, then it is programmed to always do a cool down cycle. This is 2.5 to 3 minutes. The heater must finish this cycle before it can restart. Here is the operation of the heater. This is the only job of the heater, to maintain coolant temperature. It starts and heats the coolant to about 185 degrees Fahrenheit. If it maintains the temperature, then it will cycle down to low operation. Once the coolant cools down, it will resume operation in high. If temperature is maintained in low, then the heater cycles into standby. The coolant pump is circulating, but there is no flame. The heater will restart once the coolant cools down. The coolant heater generally has a longer cycle time than an Airtronic heater. Once it starts, it may run for 30 minutes or maybe even a couple hours. In a coolant system, the heat does not blast out as with the Airtronic heater. Space heating is provided by fan units. Typically for space heating, these are low amp draw and it will take longer to reach the desired temperature inside the vehicle. It is important to understand the role of the coolant heater in a space heating application. The coolant heater heats coolant. The rest of the system distributes the heat. If you are not getting heat into the vehicle, make sure that the heat distribution part of the system is functioning properly. That is the basics for a hydronic heater. More information can be found on our website. Remember, always conduct a visual inspection before working on a heater. Thank you.